गुड मॉर्निंग. लेट अस कंटिन्यू विद द पोएम द टाइगर बाय विलियम ब्लेक. लुकिंग एट द डिटेल लाइन वाइज एक्सप्लेनेशन लाइन्स 5 to 8. इन वॉट डिस्टेंट डीप्स ऑफ स्काइज बर्न द फायर ऑफ थाइन आइज. ऑन वॉट विंग्स dare he aspire, what the hand dare the fire, dare seize the fire. The second stanza begins by asking where the tiger was created. The speaker pictures this place to be almost unimaginable, its intense strangeness emphasized by the alternative distant deeps. The mention of deeps or skies could also be a reference to hell and heaven, suggesting a sense of uncertainty about where exactly the tiger comes from, God's domain or the devil's. As in the first stanza, the tiger is again linked to fire in line 6. The fire in the tiger's eyes is suggestive of the creature's fearsome power and further its natural skill at hunting and killing. Line 7 seems to make reference to angels by mentioning wings, but this reference could be either to the virtuous angels of heaven or those that have fallen, like Satan himself. Satan is another name for the devil. Indeed, the fifth stanza later seems to support this idea. Either way, the narrator is pointing towards a casual chain of events that brought the tiger into being. That is, God created heaven, hell, and earth. He granted the world a capacity for evil as well as good, and some of his own creatures took on evil identities. So whether the tiger was created by angels, devils, or God himself, it all ultimately leads back to God. The thing that puzzles the narrator is why God wouldn't just populate the world with goodness. The narrator wants to know why fear, violence, and evil need to exist in the first place. Line 8 pushes this conundrum further with another rhetorical question, characterizing the tiger's creator as daring. Indeed, eagle-eyed readers might spot that the word dare is the only difference between the first and the last stanzas. In other words, the speaker wants to know which creator would be brave enough to introduce the tiger into the world and why. A possible answer lies in this idea of bravery itself and in Blake's overall project. Across his work, Blake does not argue for some kind of sanitized world, meaning pure, clean world, in which everything is nice and safe. The collection from which this poem is called not just Innocence, but Innocence and Experience. In Blake's view, all living creatures are the expressions of God's divine will. Everything is a part of God. Creatures as different as the lamb and the tiger, then, are both part of the full expression of God's will. And in the case of this poem, the suggestion is that these contrary states, bravery and fear, for example, cannot exist without one another. Without something to fear, there would be no courage. And perhaps this explains the presence of evil in the world. The tiger, of course, is not an inherently evil creature, but it is suggestive of evil in that it poses a dangerous and fearsome threat to other creatures. Lines 9 to 12. And what shoulder and what art could twist the sinews of thy heart? And when thy heart began to beat, what dread hand and what dread feet? The third stanza continues the poem's established pattern of rhetorical questioning. Here, considering the tiger's creation and imagining the physical strength and creative skill of its creator. As with much of the poem, there is a kind of paradox at play. That is, two opposites are playing here. The tiger, rather contradictions. The tiger is such a strong and dread creature. Dread means fearful. People are afraid. That only being more strong and dread would have the capacity to create it. For most of this stanza, the poem discusses physical effort. The tiger is such a powerful, muscular creature that the narrator wonders what shoulder would create it. These words conjure an image. Conjure means bring up to the mind an image, create an image of the sheer force of the tiger's creator, whose shoulder is strong enough to twist the sinews of the tiger. In other words, to give it life. But heart, of course, can relate to more than just the tiger's physical form. It can also relate to the tiger's way of perceiving and experiencing the world. When people talk about something being close to their heart, they are talking about something important and central to their existence. The activities close to the tiger's heart in this sense are finding prey, killing it and eating it. Prey means victim. The creator then also had to have a kind of bravery, a mental strength and skill, the word art of line 9, to bring this kind of fearsomeness into the world. The second half of the stanza foregrounds this power on the creator's part, specifically characterizing the creator as dread, because the creator would have to be in order to make a creature so threatening and powerful. Line 11 describes the moment the tiger actually comes to life, no longer part of the creator's imagination, but now a living, breathing being in its own right. The metrical regularity of line 11, which is one of the poem's few lines in simple iambic tetrameter, suggests the rhythm of the tiger's heart. And when thy heart began to beat, you can almost hear the beat of the heart. Though this moment is characterized by dread, there is still an atmosphere of awe in the lines that speaks to the astounding marvels of God's creation and of creativity more generally. Just because God creates something that is frightening, that does not make it any less miraculous. Lines 13 to 16. What the hammer, what the chain, in what furnace was thy brain? What the anvil, what dread grasp, dare its deadly terrors clasp? The fourth stanza continues with the second's in-depth consideration of the moment of the tiger's creation. But there is an important shift here. While the second stanza looked at this moment abstractly, and the third discussed the power of the creator, the fourth stanza speaks more specifically to craftsmanship and artistry. Here the narrator tries to imagine the kind of tools a creator would need to make a creature as fearsome and powerful as the tiger. The tools described are linked to a particularly industrial kind of craftsmanship, specifically relating to metalwork. The stanza conjures the image, creates an image of a noisy industrial workshop with the loud and bright assonant vowel sounds, helping the poem to turn up its volume. Hammer, chain, furnace, brain. Perhaps these images come readily to mind for Blake because of his own work as an engraver, which was a physically demanding process. But perhaps they also relate to the Industrial Revolution through which Blake was living. London was brimming with new factories, meaning there were many new factories that had come up, overflowing to almost to the extent. Basically, brimming means reaching the very top, some kind of liquid when it touches the very rim of the cup or container, that is to say it is full to the brim. So London was brimming with new factories and employees, and the streets were full of the cacophonous. Cacophonous means loud sound of metalwork. This change in society was something that Blake criticized, feeling that it was separating humankind from its natural habitat and ways of life. But just as the existence of the tiger suggests power almost beyond imagining, so too does the kind of industry described here create a sense of awesome creative power. What's more, the use of furnace in line 14 suggests a great fiery heat that perhaps in turn relates to hell. There is a sense in which the tiger seems to be forged under the same kind of pressure and heat that brought the universe itself, including hell, into being. The word forged means created or rather given shape. Just as if you have seen a blacksmith working, he first heats the piece of iron and then beats it into shape while it is still hot with the heavy hammer. So in the same way, the word forged means created. Again, the narrator is in awe of the creator's capacity to make a creature so genuinely terrifying, means frightening. The notion, the idea of being daring comes up again, as it does in the second stanza and will again in the last, characterizing the creator as someone who is not just able to create terrifying and fearsome beings, but someone who dares to. God is certainly all-powerful, the speaker seems to say. But is God really bold enough to create something so deadly? Thinking again about the way Blake often shows two contrary states side by side, there is a sense here that the daringness to create something fearful is, in a way, the reason that bravery exists. Without terror and fear, bravery and courage would have nothing to define themselves against. In other words, being brave only happens in situations that are terrifying and fearful. Following that logic, perhaps the juxtaposition of fear, juxtaposition means bringing two opposite or contradict ideas together. So perhaps the juxtaposition of fear and daring, they are two contradictory ideas, fear and daring, in this stanza, is intended as an answer to the poem's central question of why evil exists. Lines 17 to 20. When the stars threw down their spears and watered heaven with their tears, did he smile his work to see? Did he who made the lamb make thee? The fifth stanza is the poem's most notoriously ambiguous section. Ambiguous means something that is vague, something that is not absolutely clear or easy to understand. Though Blake was a devout Christian, he had his very own distinctive ideas about religion, myth, and cosmology. Indeed, he essentially constructed his own mythology that took an idiosyncratic understanding of Christianity as its building blocks. The most likely intention behind lines 17 and 18 is that they are a reference to the rebellion of angels led by Satan against God. Blake was heavily influenced by the poet John Milton, and there is certainly some overlap here with Milton's Paradise Lost. In Paradise Lost, the rebellious angels admit defeat in the face of God's awesome power. They throw down their spears. It's strongly hinted that this moment of retreat or surrender coincides with the creation of the tiger. So perhaps the existence of the tiger is such clear evidence of God's strength that the rebels have to admit defeat. Nonetheless, these fallen angels water heaven with their tears, showing how evil and suffering are now an integral part of all existence. There is no going back. Line 19 and 20 pose one of the poem's central paradoxes, means contradictions. Was God happy? In the phrase, did he smile, to have made the tiger? And by extension, is God glad to have brought evil into existence? Or, if evil is man-made, is God happy to have created a world in which humankind could create evil? The poem makes use of anaphora through the repeated did he at the start of these two rhetorical questions. The repetition helps mark this as the poem's key moment. Essentially, the narrator marvels, he's amazed at the question of whether the same creator could possibly make the lamb and the tiger. We know that the lamb, in Hindi, jisko hum bhed ka bachcha kehte hain, it is a symbol of meekness, gentleness. They are such different creatures that if a single creator did make them both, then it is very hard to understand that creator's motivations. Means why he made the tiger, and is he the same creator who has also made the lamb? Indeed, it is here that the poem makes its link with another of Blake's poems, The Lamb, explicitly obvious. Whereas the speaker in that poem is joyous and assured, utterly certain that only God could have created a creature like the lamb, the speaker in this poem is more doubtful. The speaker isn't doubtful that God made the tiger exactly, but doubtful about God's motivations, means the reasons behind the creation of the tiger. The speaker senses the limits of the speaker's own understanding, which hints towards the limits of human understanding more generally. Lines 21 to 24. Tiger, tiger, burning bright in the forest of the night, what immortal hand or eye dare frame thy fearful symmetry? The final stanza is a refrain of the first. A refrain is means lines that are repeated in any song or poem, which comes again and again. So the final stanza is more or less a repetition of the first stanza. The first stanza posed the poem's central question, who could possibly create the fearsome tiger? And the following stanzas deepened this question, asking not just who, but also why how and under what conditions and motivations the tiger came to be. The use of refrain here packs all of those other questions back into the first question. It seems that understanding the identity of the tiger's creator somehow explains all the other questions. In other words, God created the tiger, and that is the only answer that the speaker can provide. In this conclusion, the poem suggests that humans cannot hope to fully comprehend or understand the way in which God's divine will actually work. They can only marvel at it and live in accordance with God's will. There is one key difference between the first and final stanzas, apart from the subtle changes in punctuation. In line 4, the narrator asks which immortal being could create such terrifying animals as tigers, or indeed anything that seems evil. In other words, the question in the first stanza was, who has the capacity and ability to create such works? Here, though, that question is subtly but importantly reframed. The narrator, having carefully imagined the tiger's moment of creation, now asks, who would dare to create the tiger? The question is no longer ability, but about daring. This shift speaks in part to the poem's broader theme of creation and art generally. Creators need to be daring if they want their creations to be powerful. Blake himself embodies this attitude quite clearly. His art was so bold that he was generally considered a madman during his own time. What's more, this stanza's pointed use of the word dare suggests that there is something inherently brave about bringing the tiger and other terrifying things into existence. God created a world that wasn't just a nice, safe, and happy place, but rather one that contains the full range of possible experiences. Indeed, the poem suggests that bravery can only exist if there is something to fear. In other words, one can be brave only when one is afraid. There has to be some level of fear in order to bring out your hidden reserves of bravery and strength. Finally, the tiger also represents the part of God that is beyond the limits of human understanding. Humans should not pretend to know everything about existence, the poet seems to say, but should instead dare to explore the world through experiences, even or especially frightening ones. With this, we come to the end of the line-wise explanation. In the next session, we will look at the critical analysis of the poem. Thank you.